3, 2, 1. We are now not muted. Hi there, everybody. Welcome to the Escapist Movie Podcast. My name is Jack Packard.
I'm Darren Mooney.
And with us today, we have a very special guest. You might know him as one half of a writing duo, James Corey. You might know him from his Tie and That Guy podcast. You might know him because Darren and I gushed about how much we love The Expanse several times. Ty Franck, thank you so much for joining us.
Hey, thanks for having me hang out.
We're very excited to talk retro sci-fi. You know, the age of sci-fi movies before they were blockbusters, before they were considered viable, marketable products.
Literally right before Star Wars cuts off. The one that we're going to be talking about primarily is basically a year before Star Wars. This is what sci-fi looked like. I am very excited about this. Sorry.
No, as you should be. As you should be. I mean, obviously, we have to talk a little Expanse because we have you at our disposal, but not to be rude, I want to talk more about Logan's Run. So we're just going to do
I'm fine with that.
Mostly because it's a movie that is rated PG with a lot of gore and a lot of boobs, but we'll get there in just a second.
70s kids were tougher.
I guess, you know, kind of as the segue, you know, you're obviously a big sci-fi person. That's what you create primarily. You know, were movies like Logan's Run an inspiration on where you are now?
Well, I mean, for sure. Logan's Run, probably not in particular, although I did see it as a kid. I would say that the biggest inspiration on The Expanse is the movie Alien, which is, you know, that late 70s sci-fi, although much, much higher production value and you know, directed by Ridley Scott, one of the great sci-fi directors of all time. So, but yeah, I mean, that era of sci-fi is what I grew up on. I mean, original Star Trek, all that stuff. I sucked it up constantly. I mean, I was the kid who watched every episode of Space 1999 10 times, and that was terrible. Like if it was sci-fi, I was there watching it. Like, I didn't care about quality.
Oh, absolutely. And I think that's where we are. That's where we are a little bit right now, is like, there's so little like quality sci-fi to be had. It's, I'll take it. Whatever was out there, I'll take. But yeah, definitely. I can definitely see that Alien influence, that very, you know, blue collar working class side, just alien truckers. That was my favorite bit about Alien.
Truckers in space. Yeah.
We're not scientists. Yeah. We're out here working, and we have to do the distress call. Classic.
Yeah. Well, and they're not the Navy. I mean, yeah, I grew up watching.
What about
original
bonuses?
Star
Trek. Can we talk about bonuses?
Yeah, exactly. But that's a really good point. That the thing they were most concerned about was not like the prime directive or contacting alien species or fighting with Klingons. The thing they were most worried about is some people got more bonuses than other people, and they didn't think that was fair, and they wanted to argue with the boss about it. That was revolutionary when that happened. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, all the sci-fi before that was high concept. Everybody was an admiral or a captain. They were in warships. They were, you know, it was all very naval in tradition. And then Alien came along, and it was the merchant marine. You know, it was just guys with a merchant ship, and they're pissed off because that girl over there gets more bonus than they do.
Well, no, I know that's something that both Darren and I have spent far too long praising about The Expanse, is that it really tackles that kind of like worker level perspective of the future of space. And you do it so well. So by the way, just, you know, thanks for making a great show, great books, you know, in general, being nice.
Well, thank you.
That's actually probably a nice segue, though, into talking a little bit about like Logan's Run, and particularly like in the context of Alien, because it's like, we might as well go backwards if that's the way we're going on this.
I like it.
Because like, like with Alien, you have this, as you pointed out, this working class blue collar environment, people worried about bonuses, everything's rusted, everything's falling apart. You can probably go backwards and go to Star Wars and go to like the used future aesthetic, I think Lucas called it there. The idea that like the future that you live in won't be shiny and new and modern and sleek and white and brightly lit. It'll be like the present that we live in now, where all this crap is old and nobody's fixing it, nobody's maintaining it. And I think what's interesting, going back to movies like Logan's Run and kind of movies of the early 70s and back into kind of the late 60s, is they have this underlying cynicism about it that you can kind of draw a straight line through to Alien, where it's like the world is terrible, people are awful, systems in which we exist are falling apart and crumbling, and the great society is a lie and that sort of stuff. But it looks shiny and it looks sleek and it looks kind of ultra modern and hip and very, again, you know, you think of things like Kubrick's 2001 Space Odyssey, you think of things like, say, A Clockwork Orange, but even like Logan's Run just looks beautiful throughout. It's kind of interesting going back now after decades of movies like Alien and movies like Star Wars and going, no, we used to think that the future was bright and shiny and primary colors with robots that would neatly dissolve any dead bodies the fascist cops killed.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's true on the surface, but keep in mind, if you've seen Logan's Run recently, Logan's Run, their society has a basement.
Yeah.
And the part where they're hanging out and they're having orgies and they're taking designer drugs and all of that, that's in the shiny glass bubble, right? But at one point, he has to pursue some people down beneath that. And there's a basement down there, and it's dirty, and it's grimy, and people are hiding in the walls like rats. So I think the shininess, even within the context of Logan's Run, is a veneer. Yeah. It's the shiny thing placed over the top of the gritty, awful basement where the terrible things are happening underneath. And I think that is a really common sci-fi theme, that even when you do have the shiny future, it's always built on a foundation that is not shiny. There's something underneath there that the people living in the shiny world choose to ignore,
right,
so that they can have their fancy society. I don't know if you guys are readers, but Ursula Le Guin wrote a story called Those Who Walk Away from Omalis. Yeah. And it's literally that story of the perfect society but down in a basement, there's one horribly tortured person, and the perfect society can only exist because this person is down there being horribly treated. And that's what the society is built on.
Sure.
And I think that's a direct reaction to things like Logan's Run, where you've got the shiny orgy city, and then underneath you got people living in the walls like rats.
Sure. Or something more modern, like a Snowpiercer. Also dissecting that, like, if we sacrifice one, everyone gets to live. Yeah, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
And well, the people in the basement who are eating the bugs so that we can have our train car that's just a club.
Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
But I like that. No. It's a really good point. Like, but when what I really love is when you go down to the basement, the architecture is the same. It's still got that kind of 70s pattern, the circles and designs of the walls. So it's not even as if like it's built atop these ruins. It's these ruins are part of it. They've just been overgrown and not maintained. It's not that it's a freak accident that the place is like this. It's built like this, which is very like something I really loved about how well put together that world is in Logan's Run, I think.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, and just like the running theme is, you know, like characters, you know, Logan's Run doesn't do a ton to kind of visually get across a lot of its idea because it is, you know, early low budget sci-fi. But like the character stating over and over like, oh, I guess this is how the power works. I've never really thought about it. Oh, I guess we're built here for some reason. I've never really thought about it. And I think that was the one of the most fun themes of their like privilege is like, oh, I guess I've never thought about it because I've never had to. And the second I do, everything crumbles and breaks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. The other thing about Logan's Run that you just made me think of, that even as a kid, I wondered about this, is what is the purpose of that society? And when you dig down, the only purpose of that society is to exist, to self-perpetuate. Mm. That's all it does. It never moves beyond that. They make some babies. Those babies live to be, I don't know what the death age is, like 25 or whatever it is.
30. You can't. 30 is the death age. Yeah.
The death age.
It's you 20 die in the novel and 30 in the film. Yeah.
Oh.
Right. And then you are replaced by another vat-grown baby. And at no point does anybody try to achieve anything beyond that.
Like to the point where like they have offhanded conversations where they're like, why would you ever care who your mother is? We have sex right. to do. Come on.
Right.
which I think is a beautiful, I'm not sure it probably delves more into it into the novelization or not the novelization, the book version of Logan's Run, but it is a lovely commentary on privilege, though that's not necessarily what the movie is about.
Yeah.
I always like on this most recent rewatch, it was startling to me how much this is just a parable of starting a family and leaving your party days behind you. It's so simple and dumb where it's like, my best friend hates me because I found a new girl and I want to start a family.
I mean, I think you could also argue that kind of fits into that mold of the stereotype of everything in 70s American pop culture being a reaction to Watergate and Vietnam and the idea of like coming out of the 60s. Because it's notable that like the Logan's Run society that we see is built on a warped, malformed version of 60s utopianism and 60s idealism. Like the use of primary colors, the fact that like it's literally a free love society. They have like teleporting Tinder, which is, you know, one of the more interesting aspects of the movie as well. But you have this idea that it is built on this idea of like free love, except it's completely hollow and completely empty. And the movie itself seems to be like that thing that you have in American pop culture when you get into the 70s. Think of like, and I think when we talked about this, we said like, are we saying 70s sci-fi or are we starting like a little bit earlier? I'd say late 60s, coming out of things like, say, Planet of the Apes, which is a very similar movie. It's another kind of apocalyptic nightmare. It's about a society that is built wrong and the lies that society is kind of built upon and the realization that you have when you begin to question that. And then things like, say, Soylent Green, which is very similar as well, that also has like a cannibalism subplot like this does as well, where it's like, oh, by the way, the people are also food stuff and things like that. Or even say Charlton Heston in The Omega Man. But you have this idea, I think, in Logan's Run of, well, this society where we've all been promised that if we behave ourselves, there's a chance that we won't be chosen. Like when we get taken to the carousel, when our last day arrives, there's a chance that like we could get ahead, we could beat the rat race, we could ascend, we could reach the top. And you have that wonderful moment where Logan asks his partner and he's like, hey, have you ever like seen anybody get renewed? And he's like, ah, yeah, sure, lots of people. He's like, yeah, but specifically, can you name one person who actually like succeeded in this rat race that we're running? It's like, that's a silly question. Stop asking silly questions. But like, yeah. I go a bit bigger. I'd say it is that nuclear family thing, absolutely. But I do think that it is a broader, or maybe it's just soaking something in the atmosphere. Maybe it's not a conscious thing, but I think it is a broader kind of very 70s sci-fi movie in that sense, I would argue.
Well, Carousel always makes me think of, and I apologize to anyone who's religious, always makes me think of religion. You know, if you're just good enough, God will, at the end of your life, God will fix everything. Mm-hmm. And they are, there is an almost religious fervor to the whole, we gather and we watch Carousel and that, you know, that it's very you got robes on that you take off before
very
you go up.
Very ceremonial, yes.
It's very
and you
ceremonial,
ascend, you literally
get
lifted up. Like you literally
and
get,
you
like,
get lifted up, yeah. And there is the subtext. They never say it, but there is a subtext that the people who are shot with the laser beam were unworthy, right? So it's you weren't worthy to ascend.
Ooh.
And that's why the laser beam shot you.
You weren't chosen, right.
You weren't chosen, mm-hmm. Yeah. So you were unworthy. And that has a very religious feel to me, which also I think, you know, the 60s and 70s were still in the throes of an anti-religion sort of movement.
That sort of counterculture thing coming out of here.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sure.
I mean, you have the hand as well. Like, again, it's probably not too specific an image, but you have the idea that it looks like stigmata. It starts glowing red when your time is chosen, you know?
Yeah.
You know what? I grew up Catholic and I never put that together. That's absolutely
true. Because you're a bad Catholic and you won't, you're going to be shot with the laser beam when you try to fly up to heaven.
Yeah. I am Irish. That is how I know. I just reflexively, is it a Christ metaphor? Is the first thing that I ask when I see something.
That's the default. Yeah.
Yeah. Will I go to hell for watching this? Is the question I ask myself every time.
And the answer is always yes, is the fun part.
Yeah.
especially if it's sci-fi. Well, I, you know, like I said, to me, I think if I want to be very glib, and I, you know, I think it's more funny to be glib, is like if we go through all the beats of this story, it all boils down to my bachelor days are done. Like literally, his world changes and gets drastically worse as soon as he meets the girl he's gonna marry. And then, you know, he starts shirking his friend responsibilities. His friend is covering for him.
He's 30 yeah. before he knows what's happening. He's like, I was 26 yesterday. And it's like, no, you're 30 now. Life's yeah. over, mate.
He even, you know, like the old man that they meet in the Library of Congress or in Congress or wherever that's supposed to be is like,
Peter Ustinov, yeah.
like literally calls him their child and, you know, beloved and beloved. It's so funny how it's just like, oh, growing old kind of sucks. You literally die when you grow old.
But like,
Ty, sorry. Oh, no. I started talking at the same time. I wonder if being scarred by this movie early on is the reason I have chosen to never adult. I'm in my early 50s and I married my childhood sweetheart because we were sweethearts when we were kids and we wanted to hang out together. But you know what our afternoons are? We go downstairs into my big screening room and we play co-op video games. We've never had kids. We spend all of our time goofing off, playing video games, mm-hmm. watching movies. We take long trips. Like the whole idea of turning into that kind of adult where you have a 9-to-5 job and you raise kids and you worry about like Montessori and all that, that always felt like, honestly, that always felt like death to me. And I wonder if Logan's Run ruined me. I wonder if Logan's Run ruined me because I watched that at an early age and was like, oh my God, that's, The subtle metaphor of this movie has changed my brain chemistry.
Like, think about it. You know, the runner, after Logan's revelation, the runner is like an older woman who's like, no, I'm young. I'm so young.
I'm 22.
Yeah. Yeah.
In the ball gown, in that kind of contrast of the place falling apart. Actually, that's probably a good question, Ty, in terms of like, you saw this when you were young. This would have yeah. been, so 77, like, did you see it when it first came out? Did you see it like, did you wait for repertoire speeds to come to VHS? How did you come to Logan's Run actually?
What
kind of movies did you associate with it?
I believe the first time I saw Logan's Run was on TV, but I don't remember what it, I mean, nobody, when I was like 10, nobody had a VCR, mm-hmm. but, There were channels, there were stations that basically showed nearly uncut movies, right? Like there was, what was the one out of Chicago that showed like movies constantly?
Oh, sure. KLTV, was that it?
No, it was like TBS. No, not TBS, but it was.
Was this the one interrupted by Max Headroom? Is it by any chance? Am I
thinking
the same one?
No, but
there was those channels and if you watched those channels late at night, they showed basically uncut movies, right? Older movies, mm-hmm. but uncut. And I remember seeing Logan's Run. I stayed up late because I would stay up late to watch sci-fi. I stayed up late and I watched that movie and I was young enough that it was very titillating, right? Because there's yeah. beautiful girls in very see-through outfits and, you know, all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But also I think I was old enough that it was possible to be titillated. And also old enough that like some of the other themes kind of probably hit me at exactly the right time. That idea that growing up seems horrible and, you know, maybe that stuff like rewrote my brain. It's entirely possible. But, you know, what's funny is I saw it once as a kid and I had very vivid memories of it for decades. And I didn't rewatch it again until I was in my 40s. So there was probably a good 30-year gap there where I had not seen that movie, but I had such vivid memories of it that when I rewatched it in my 40s, I my memory of the movie was almost perfect. Like I was like, oh, this is exactly the movie I remember. Because often it's not that way. You rewatch old movies and mm-hmm. they seem very different when you see them when you're older.
Well, it's a very visual movie. Like, the production design is absolutely astounding. Like, the way in which the sets look, the way in which they build, like, the monorail car to arrive at, like, is it arcade is what they call it? Mm-hmm. The kind of center place. The fact that you have all these big, wide open spaces and the fact that it does look very 70s-esque. I think it's shot by Ernest Laszlo. I think it was Kubrick's cinematographer as well. So it has, it looks like 70s sci-fi. Like you, and again, I think it got dinged for this on release. I think a lot of people were like, this is very old fashioned. This is very out of date. And it arrived a year before Star Wars. And so, like, the paradigm shifted. Mm-hmm. But I think that, like, when I think of, and it's kind of funny that when Jack said we're doing kind of 70s sci-fi, it's like the first place my brain went was Logan's Run, because that's what I associate. Like, you mentioned that Logan's Run is exactly the movie that you think it is. It absolutely is. I suspect that there are other movies that if you ask me about them, I've just picked images from Logan's Run and just slotted them in because it looks like they kind of fit in that sense. It's arguably the perfect kind of snapshot of this moment in sci-fi, I would argue, I think.
I would say that Logan's Run is the most 70s sci-fi movie that has ever existed.
I think, like, for the miniatures alone, that is true, which are gory. I mean, they're so obviously miniatures, but they are also so
gorgeously
detailed. Like, that initial overshot of all the domes where you just know, like, those are like car headlights or whatever. It doesn't matter.
Right.
It's so beautiful. The tiny miniature monorails and the tubes as exterior shots. Oh, I could watch just a montage of those all day.
And the way in which the camera follows the miniature that you're supposed to be following, which is, again, a very nice touch directorially. Like, because you have the other miniatures going around. It's not like, oh, this is an establishing shot. It's like, no, this is meant to be a tracking shot through a model.
Yeah.
And again, it's kind of thing that you, again, would arguably be passé when Lucas came up with Star Wars the following year and you got used to a different style of, like, special effects. But I love this stuff. And you mentioned watching it at midnight, and that's probably where I kind of found it as well. I found it, like, flipping around my granddad's VHS collection or whatever. But it was weird because it looked somehow like everything I imagined that era science fiction looked like, except it was actually a single whole entity, if that makes sense. It was like a cohesive movie, while being all science fiction movies for me. Remarkable.
Yeah, you know, one thing that I noticed, and I don't know if this was intentional or if this is my brain just trying to put puzzle pieces together, but those exterior tracking shots of the car that they're in going from pod to pod, like when they went to what was like the child anarchy area called? Do you guys remember?
I don't remember what it was called, but it was one of those basement areas.
Right.
Well, yeah.
Where the kids are just running wild.
The kids are
killing
each other. But like that,
as you do,
like that shot of following the little car had these like little bumps and hiccups to it where I almost wonder if they were trying to emulate like a helicopter tracking shot. Because of course they could do it very smoothly, but they say, oh, what if we add, like, you know, in digital now, we just add shake and post to make it look more real. But I wonder if that was a little touch to be like, no, this is really shot from a helicopter, guys.
Yeah. I
have to think it probably was right.
Yeah.
That they were trying to get And I remember watching those shots of the cars racing along the pods, and I really wanted to ride in one of those. You know, the little car and this clear tube, hundreds of feet. I mean, the way the shots are set up, it looks like it's hundreds of feet above the ground. That thing looked awesome. I totally wanted to ride that when I was a kid.
Like, who cares how, probably, what a pain in the ass it is to use those cars, because only two people can ride at a time, and it's a civilization with teleporters, so why do you even need them?
They're cool, Jack. That's why you need them. Like, they look cool.
Not every place you want to go has a telepod in it.
Fair.
Sometimes you're not doing late night Tinder or whatever it is that he's doing. But, you know,
telepods are for random anonymous sex.
Only for sex.
Not for work.
Boss, we
for
could.
Pleasure, not for work.
We could transport all the food through this too. It would save us hours of work. Nope. Only for random sex.
Yeah.
That's
you ever taken a black
idea.
Light
we
into
know.
One of those things? You don't want your food in there.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't use a telepod, and I don't want to fraternize with anybody who does. Thank you very much.
You definitely want to wear your flip-flops when you walk into that thing.
Oh, God. I do love that that's like, that's our introduction to our female lead, our love interest to Logan's Run, is he's just looking for a fuck buddy, you know, comes across like a little S&M dude and like, oh, not tonight. Ooh, you lady. And then,
but think how weirdly progressive that was, that when a dude is flipping the sex channels, other dudes can show up in the sex channels, and it's not treated like this huge, like, oh, what are you doing in there, man? Yeah. There's no gay panic to it, right?
That's very, he even mentions to her, like, oh, I'm sorry if you didn't get what you want. Were you looking for a lady? Yeah, which, like, he seemed very cool with. You're absolutely right. That was very progressive.
Yeah, there's no gay panic to that moment. Mm-hmm. And that is, think about what the 70s were like, and for gay people living in America or even in Europe, that to have it just be so casual that, like, if you're a dude, you step in the pod, you might get up with another dude. That's not a big deal, you know? Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, they wind up with, of course, the guy and the girl wind up paired up because it's a movie in America, so you have to end up there. But
you always have to stamp that not gay button. Even if it's flirted with, stamp it hard.
I do kind of want the version of Logan's Run where it's Logan and the S&M guy, and he's just wearing the S&M outfit for the whole thing. It's very Zardoz, though. It is very Zardoz.
If they do a remake of that movie, that has to be the premise. He sticks with the S&M dude, and they go on the run. That's amazing.
I have to imagine.
And he lands on Jessica 6 the first time, and he's like, no, not tonight.
You kind of look basic. I can only imagine if they did a remake, the like gay tension between him and Francis 4 or his
7, I think.
Francis 7, his cop partner, would be pumped up significantly, because that's definitely the subtext, right?
I mean, those two were definitely fucking. I mean,
it explicitly showed them like in a fuck buddy pile.
With a purple mist as well, a literal purple haze.
I mean, absolutely. And when you have two men that pretty in an orgy, they're going to wind up bumping into each other. Come on.
I mean, not by accident either.
Not by accident.
You just got to go with it.
What's the actor's name who plays his buddy? He's done a ton of stuff.
Richard Jordan, I think.
I believe you.
Is that his name?
Richard Jordan, I believe, is Francis 7. Obviously, Michael York is Logan. Mm-hmm.
Okay. But that actor, I remember, like, because obviously I had seen the movie as a kid, and then I remember watching it again later in my 40s. And I actually just rewatched it about 6 months ago, so it's pretty fresh in my head. But when I rewatched it in my 40s, seeing that guy and going, oh my God, that guy, he's like that guy. He's in every movie.
Is he Duncan Idaho in Dune, if I remember correctly?
He is.
Is that the
He's Duncan Idaho in Lynch's Dune. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah.
Well, you know, I being...
Like I'm just browsing through his filmography here. So, like, Old Boyfriends, Race of Titanic, The Yakuza, The Bunker, The Secret of My Success, The Hunt for Red October, Gettysburg, and Posse.
Ooh. Wow.
Yeah.
No,
that dude's been in everything.
As someone who watched this movie, you know, later in their life, and obviously I'm a bit younger than you, Ty, like, for me, it was just so funny seeing...
Oh, obviously you are. Obviously.
Just a little bit, you know, you can't tell from up here, but I only shave because it shows my gray hair. For me, it was just so funny seeing Basil Exposition starring in an action movie.
Right.
Because, of course, that was my introduction
to
Michael
Basil
York.
Exposition.
I would give, like, I think one of the things that works really well for Logan's Run is the fact that it does pick these British actors. Like, obviously, Jenny Agutter as well is also, like, she's a primarily British stage and television actor. And it's really odd and disconcerting to see her here and in the Avengers and, like, nothing else in American cinema. I think it works really well because, like, the movie asks, like, Logan to give a lot of exposition and a lot of, like, well, as you know, this is how the world works, and there's a lot of stuff to get through here. And I think York does it rather well, like, because, you know, again, in this era of science fiction, it's like, well, we generally go with Charlton Heston, and he's a big, burly, manly man who, like, he's got no gruff, he will get a gun and shoot a bunch of stuff, wear a loincloth, he's gonna look good shirtless, he's gonna be very masculine, very aggressive. Mm-hmm. I think York is interesting because he seems like he's totally at ease. He's very, and again, you could arguably say he's underplaying it, but he's very at ease with the world in which he starts out. But he's also very confident doing the stuff that the script needs him to do in terms of delivering exposition and explaining how this world works. And I think that works to the movie's credit. I think, like, having Basil Exposition quite literally delivering the exposition is one of the things that kind of makes it pop, because he doesn't feel like Charlton Heston in another one of these movies around this time or whatever. He feels slightly different. Oh, sorry.
Well, York has a great voice.
Yeah.
He has a beautiful voice. And so just listening to him talk is nice. And so when he's delivering a lot of dialogue, a lot of exposition, it's okay, because he's just pleasant to listen to. The thing is, it's funny that you mentioned Heston. Like, I'm sitting here thinking of what Logan's Run would look like with Heston instead of York. And it wouldn't be Logan's Run. It would be Logan wrecks some shit. Because it'd be like, Logan's not running if it's Charlton Heston.
That's right.
Logan's running at you.
Logan's like, all right, I guess this society needs to be torn down. Let me get my gun.
What's the second Planet of the Apes movie? What's that one called? I can't remember what it is. But the one where Charlton Heston basically said, look, I'll come back as long as at the end of the movie I get to blow up the Planet of the Apes. And the franchise continues for three movies afterwards. It's amazing. Heston would be very much, you wouldn't have that sense of he's out of his depth. He has no idea what's going on. And he's very confused and disoriented. It would be very much, I'm angry and I'm going to fix this.
That's right. I'm not going to destroy the mother brain with my psychedelic inner psyche spouting truths. I'm going to shoot the mother brain, and that's how I'm going to win.
Yeah, Logan's Run would seem much more like, you ever see that movie Equilibrium?
Yes.
It would turn into Equilibrium, where he would just go to the main office there and just shoot all the computers.
Was it actually called Gunkata?
Yeah. Oh yeah, Gunkata.
The martial art of using guns. I don't think enough people recognize how brilliant Equilibrium is. That's a whole nother podcast. We'll save that for another day.
Well, save it for later. But Equilibrium is a 70s sci-fi movie that just got made in the 2000s.
So very true, which is why it is underappreciated.
No, it is, because it's got that same sense of like society is broken and odd and like it doesn't really work and everything you've been told is a lie and you better... Because again, it feels like that kind of relic of the 90s as a hangover of the 70s, where you had things like Oliver Stone and things like The X-Files. And it was all kind of like harking back to this kind of paranoid mood. And I have to admit, and again, this is kind of like when we talk about that idea of like 2000s movies that are secretly 60s movies. Rewatching this, I was struck by how Tim Burton's Planet of the Apes, like its big twist at the end, obviously isn't the Statue of Liberty sequence from the original Planet of the Apes, but it feels like a nod to the sequence in this where they leave the dome, they leave the city, and they go out and they discover Washington, D.C. And it's like, that's Abraham Lincoln and he's old. And it's like Tim Burton was like, okay, I'm doing my homage to Planet of the Apes, but I want it to be Logan's Run. And instead of realizing that people can get old, he realizes that Abraham Lincoln's a monkey. That's what we're doing now. There's a lot of that in there in the way, like, because it's the same stuff where it's the progression where he goes through the National Mall. He sees like the kind of Washington Monument. He goes in, he visits Abraham Lincoln. And part of me is like, this has to have been like an influence in some way when they're remaking Planet of the Apes and going, we can't do the Statue of Liberty. That's been done. Everybody knows that. Let's maybe do a riff on kind of Logan's Run. And you have that sequence where they find Ustinov kind of wandering around inside the Congress. And I think the rumor is that's the same set they use for Mr. Smith Goes to Washington as well, which is like the perfect metaphor for like how American politics were in the 70s. It's like, we took the sets from this classic story of like American idealism and exceptionalism, and we just let it get overgrown and kind of like decayed and collapse into itself. And we have, you know, Peter Ustinov wandering around having no idea what's actually going on. Absolutely. Which is kind of interesting. And I don't know if we're at the point where we talk about the end, because like, I want to ask you guys, like, do you think Logan's Run has a happy ending or a sad ending?
I think the ending becomes happy once they get past the terrible robot. Because I got to say, the part that almost ruins that movie for me is the robot. Like, I love it.
Protein from the sea. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That robot. My brain when I was a kid made that robot sequence much smaller, and then when I rewatched it later in my 40s, I was like, Jesus Christ, how long are we going to be with this stupid fucking robot?
It's weird.
Once they got past that,
it's a 70s movie. You have to have a robot. It's like Forbidden Planet. It has to like have flailing arms and be malfunctioning somehow. You know, it's Danger Will Robinson,
and made basically out of tinfoil.
Yeah. Not basically. Like those are drier, lint dryer tubes on his arms.
They're dryer tubes.
That is classic cardboard box robot.
When you see the close-up, you can see his teeth. Like, when they do the close-up of the face, you can see his lips and teeth.
To be fair, Box does say, not man, not machine, something better. So it's plausible within the reality. Not to actually you, Darren, but it's plausible within the reality that he does have teeth.
He's some kind of cyborg?
Yes. that whole sequence is very confusing from a storytelling perspective, because I was always unsure if whether or not the frozen naked people were runners or if they were the people teleported from the carousel that they are now using as food.
I got the impression that they were runners.
And that's very likely.
The idea that no runner's ever gotten further than him, which is very strange when, like, that Logan and sort of Jessica do is run really fast. It's like, I feel like you weren't the first people to try that approach with him, but it's interesting that it worked. And the idea
there's the old dude outside, you know? I mean, clearly, somebody's out there.
He was born outside, I think, is the thing, isn't it? Like, so he didn't get past Box. Box is like the end.
But maybe his parents got past Box.
Something to think about. Yeah. Also, it should be noted, while we do, you know, applaud a lot of the progressive nature of the movie, Box is also the only actor of color in the entire film, as the future of Logan's run is incredibly white.
It is incredibly white. And what's interesting is watching it like 6 months ago, I hadn't really, you know, obviously you don't notice the things you don't notice. And when I was a little kid, I didn't notice that. And what's weird is when I was a little kid, I was literally the only white kid in my neighborhood. I didn't have a white friend until junior high. Mm-hmm. All the kids in my neighborhood were black or Hispanic. It was a black and Hispanic, largely black and Hispanic neighborhood. And so it's not like I was used to only seeing white people, but I remember watching that movie. And I think what it was is I was used to sci-fi being white. That when you watch sci-fi movies, all the people in sci-fi movies are white. So it didn't feel weird that all the people in Logan's Run were white because it was a sci-fi movie. Yeah. And I think that's said something about, you know, early sci-fi. But I remember watching it again 6 months ago and it finally hitting me, like, holy shit, this is just a sea of white butts, ain't it?
Literally. White butts and boobs everywhere.
Everywhere, yeah. It was, but you know, you don't become aware of the things that you're not aware of until you become aware of them. That's the great paradox, right?
Absolutely.
You finally become aware of something and then you're like, oh, holy shit. Right.
Yeah. Right.
No wonder people were pissed off.
Something I definitely want to dig into is Logan's Run. I genuinely love Logan's Run, and I do wish more people would hold it up as the sci-fi classic it is, though it does come to a screeching halt, like, as soon as they kind of get outside and the entire narrative changes to this whole, like, what is the sun? What the hell is going on? I'm in pain. What is outside? And it almost turns into a surrealist film, them talking to the old man, and it's just slow and silent of just like, what the hell are you and why are you? And I love that it does that.
Can I ask a question? Like, this, how strange did the old man seem when we watched it as children versus how strange did the old man seem when we watched it in like the past 6 months, where it seems like he's the one man on earth who loved cats? Because he's quoting from T.S. Eliot's and he's quoting from Cats. And like, when I was a kid, this was strange and bizarre and I had no idea where this information was coming from. But I'm watching it now and I'm like, man, this is a real Andrew Lloyd Webber fan. This is obviously what he's into. Cats survived the apocalypse.
In the remake, he wouldn't be in a library full of books. He'd be in a video store and the only DVD is the new Cats. Yeah.
Oh, wow, that really is an apocalypse.
He's just quoting Tay Sway all the time. It would be great.
Oh my god.
But go ahead.
No, go ahead. Sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, like, it's a really bold choice, I think, for a movie to make to so harshly switch gears from, you know, like, bright color sci-fi to just the characters not understanding what we know as basic information and really taking the time to hammer that point home almost... to annoyance. I mean, like, my love.
When they can't figure out why there are numbers on tombstones and stuff like that sort of thing, yeah?
Sure, but I do like...
What does it mean, beloved husband, beloved wife?
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah.
But that's a very 70s sci-fi thing. I mean, that sort of... You can't just let your subtext be subtext. Mm. Somebody's got to like actually stand there and explain it. I mean, you look at Omega Man, you know, the original with Vincent Price.
Sure. The precursor to Will Smith's I Am Legend. Right.
Yeah. But I mean, Omega Man is just I Am Legend again.
Oh, sure.
But
yeah.
It's, the subtext there of he's actually the monster.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They play it. They really underplay it. It's actually fairly subtle. You get to Omega Man and it's like all the subtlety is gone. It's just, he's the monster. And you know, and he's the white man murdering black people, mm-hmm. right. Is what it turns into. The Logan's Run, the end is very like, here was the subtext of our movie. Now let us explain it to you in the next half hour. You watch movies like, remember Silent, was it Silent Running? The one with Bruce Stern where he's got the three robots and he's taking care of the last plans.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. That one. It's like our movie is about humanity not taking care of biodiversity. And we're going to spend an hour and a half explaining to you that humanity has not taken care of biodiversity. Like there's no subtlety to the message at all. It was a weirdly kind of, late 60s early 70s kind of way of telling stories. I'm not sure why that they felt the need to hammer you with those themes.
Again, yeah, you mentioned Star Trek as an inspiration. Star Trek is full of those sorts of metaphors where it's like, oh, you're half black and half white on one side and you're half black and half white on the other side. Why can't you get along? It's silly that you can't. The kind of people who would judge people based on their skin color is terrible. I don't know what we're possibly commenting on here. Yeah, no, it absolutely is. It's very much kind of like of a piece
anything.
With that.
Yeah.
And like the thing about Logan's Run that I do find interesting, it's kind of the two points that I think Jack and Ty both made there, is that like, that sequence where they get out into the real world, so to speak, or outside the dome, is very like the sequence that you expect at the end of any kind of 70s movie. Like, again, Planet of the Apes in 1968, where it's like, oh, he gets out into the wasteland and he discovers that the world is ruined and that it was Earth all along and that our civilization has collapsed and the apes have risen from that. Mm-hmm. And like, here it's that, but it's drawn out, which I find interesting. Instead of it being like, well, okay, he goes to the Lincoln Memorial and he realizes that there is no life outside. Instead, the movie spends 20 or 30 minutes doing that and then has him go back and kind of like, again, or I don't want to compare it to Mad Max Fury Road, because when you compare any movie to Mad Max Fury Road, it doesn't seem flattering. But like, no, he goes out and he realizes that there's nothing beyond the dome, that he's running nowhere. And Jack's right, the pace of the movie slows down because he's no longer running. There's no longer any forward momentum. Mm-hmm. And he realizes that he can't stay outside, or he there's nothing out there. The only way to do it is to fix inside, is to go back to the dome and to fix that, mm-hmm. basically. Which again, I think is a very interesting point in terms of like going to like the stereotypical end of a 70s movie, which is like, as you point out, Charlton Heston. Oh, by the way, Charlton Heston's a monster. Well, I guess that's the end of, you know, that's how the matter is. Or it's kind of like the Statue of Liberty's in the sea. That's mm-hmm. that's the end right. of it. And in contrast, Logan's Run going, no, actually, you can go back and you can maybe like tear it down or fix it. And I don't think the movie says you can fix it, because it's really weird when like you have this shot of all the young people crowding around the old man who can't remember his own name, and you have like Jerry Goldsmith's score kind of like soaring triumphantly, and it's like the movie almost sells you as this kind of like happy triumphant, well, they fixed it, haven't they, moment. But then you get this kind of like the score goes a bit quiet, and you get the shot of like Jessica and Logan, and they're smiling. But they're smiling overlaid with all this imagery of kind of like the smoking dome or the burning fire yes. or like right. the empty mall. And I kind of love that the movie is kind of ambiguous in that point, where like you you seem initially like it's going to be, oh, the world is ruined, that's the end. It's like, no, okay, they're going back, they're going to fix it, that's the end. And then instead it goes, well, they brought the system down, but I don't know what the next step here is. Do you? I kind of like that the movie has that ambiguity around it.
Well, I mean, somebody's going to have to learn how to be a farmer pretty fucking quick. now that the telepods aren't just cranking out food or whatever. But that's another weird thing about that movie. It's interesting you brought that up because I was thinking about that earlier. Is it's a society where some people seem to have jobs. Yeah. Like Sandmen, that's a job, right? And there are people who work in the computer center for the Sandmen. That seems like a job.
And there are plastic surgeons.
And there are plastic surgeons.
And you,
plastic surgeons.
You have to assume that someone mops up in the sex room.
Right? Is
oh, no, they have a robot. Just comes over and does the like disintegration.
Yeah. Oh, I suppose.
That's not a robot.
Love the idea
that's a scooter. That's
I love
like
that they repurpose. Sorry.
That's right. That's a guy
it's
on
a scooter. There's a guy riding it.
Yeah,
he drives it over the body. Yeah.
Ah, yeah.
But like, is there someone to like refill the sex drug in the sex room? Like, or does the computer take care of that?
Yeah.
Well, and he has a bunch of stuff in his room. He has a bunch of like bottles of booze and stuff. Are there stores? Do you go there and buy those things? Does somebody bring those to your place? You never get any sense of how the society actually works. You get a sense that there are some people have jobs, but you also get a sense that having a job is kind of a choice.
Yes. Yeah.
But then that makes you wonder who chooses to be a Sandman? Who goes, you know what I'd really love to do? Shoot some people in the back and disintegrate them. That sounds amazing. And the only opportunity for that is if I become a Sandman.
But that kind of makes sense within context of the movie because the Sandmen seem to be having a great time.
Yeah.
And
they're
it's
having a great time. That first dude,
they heard him. They heard him. Like they just like chase him with the gun. It's like, do you want to shoot him? No, just shoot the ground and make him turn around and run. Get him in a corner and make him throw himself off the, almost make himself throw himself off. Yeah.
Yeah, they watch
like, there's sadism the there. They enjoy it.
That's true.
Like they're sociopaths.
But it's a society that does that. That's the kind of thing that I was wondering about with the carousel sequence, where it's like, is this a society that takes like pleasure in like part of it's obviously you want to see them ascend, but like you know that they have never seen anybody actually ascend, so they're all cheering and laughing, and it's this wonderful thing that you get again very common in 60s and 70s science fiction where society is so fundamentally broken. Think of like Rollerball or movies like that,
yeah,
where
sure.
It's like you're cheering. You're cheering for like watching these people get zapped or evaporated or kind of die.
Absolutely.
Or suffer. And it's this dissonance, which is fantastic, where everybody's really happy, but like everything is terrible, which I kind of love.
It's funny you bring up Rollerball because I was actually thinking of the scene in Rollerball where at a party to have fun, they go outside and they shoot trees.
Yeah.
And they have like a gun that makes this gun makes trees explode. And the fun thing to do is go outside and blow up trees.
Yeah.
Which... like who thinks that's fun? But you know, apparently these people do.
Sure, or even we can look at kind of the mundane activities. I kept thinking of THX while watching Logan's Run. You know, very similar.
Yes.
Hidden society. Of course, THX is that classic. I'm outside of the city. Now what? Credits roll. But you know, like the masturbatotron that is in THX.
Right.
Is very similar to the just like this weird techno opulence that is in Logan's Run. But and I guess like
by the way, I do not want to have the job of cleaning the masturbatotron. I do not want that job. That's not it.
Yeah, you wonder
and
if
they're handing out jobs. That's not the job I hope.
Somebody's got to clean the tubes, Ty. Who's gonna clean it?
Yeah, like again, the pleasure the Sandmen take. You wonder if the guy cleaning like the sexobatorium is just as enthusiastic about his work.
You know what?
Like,
there's some,
like
there's some
freaks
out there.
People based on their enthusiasms. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like he
we don't judge. It's like,
gets up every morning, and go, oh, I can't wait to clean up those masturbatotrons. Hey, oh, I got the. I love the smell.
How did that get in there?
Oh. yeah. But you know, sorry. That's the future.
We are very mature individuals.
We're very mature individuals.
Yeah, it's a very 60s, 70s idea of like what the future is. It's going to involve lots of sex and it's going to involve lots of primary colors, but like there's probably going to be mass executions that people are going to really enjoy. But again, Death Race 2000 was around this time as well. If I remember correctly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like in terms of again that weird like, and it's not it is dystopian science fiction, but it's weird dystopian science fiction because now we think of dystopian science fiction of like people scowling and like wandering the wasteland wearing sunglasses and leather jackets, mm-hmm. even though it's like really hot and would probably be uncomfortable. You know, back in the 70s, it was like, yeah, it's terrible, but people seem to be really enjoying how terrible it is. Like taking this kind of sadistic glee in like, because yeah, the Sandmen are like, they're terrible. They're terrible. So happy at how... They're so happy. Like that Logan goes from like kujikooing a little baby in his like introductory kind of sequence to no, I'm gonna just like step outside and we're gonna play with this guy for about 10 minutes. Yeah. You know?
Let's take a moment here, because I gotta leave in a couple minutes, but let's take a moment here, since you're talking about the shooting scene, to talk about the amazing prop that those guns were.
Yes.
One of the things I remembered from seeing it as a kid, as I spent the rest of my childhood trying to recreate that gun, because it was the most badass gun I had ever seen. The green flames that shoot out the side when it fires. That thing was so cool. And to this day, I want to know what that prop consisted of, because clearly it had some kind of gas that it was ejecting, mm-hmm. and igniting when they fired it.
Yes.
What was going on there? Like that. Well, you're a filmmaker too, Jack, so you know, like I'm a filmmaker. When I see stuff like that, my first thought is, how did they make that?
Right.
It's amazing.
Right.
I
like, is it blanks and they're using a special kind of powder to give that green color? Or is it just like a fancy lighter and they're just like a special kind of butane in there? Right. Ooh, yeah.
Like, are they shooting some, like you said, some kind of gas out the side that's burning that cool green color?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I for the rest of my childhood, I wanted to make one of those.
Well, we talked earlier about like the beautiful miniatures, the beautiful props, the costumes, yeah. even though like they're very like 60s, the women get a towel and the men get full outfits.
Yeah.
But
the men get a full body covering jumpsuit. The women get like you said, a towel.
It's like a sheet. It's like a nice sheet, but you know, there's no bras in the future.
There are no bras,
as George Lucas so classily puts it.
And no woman's clothing is allowed to go more than 1 inch down her thigh.
Absolutely. So just, you know, wonderful movie. Obviously, go watch it if you haven't seen it. Ty, I know you have to go, but we appreciate the time that you are able to give us. You know, we're not the biggest audience, but if there's anything you want to plug, you do it right here.
I have a TV show. I have some books.
Just a couple books. Just
small books. Yeah.
My friend Wes Chatham and I have a podcast called Ty and That Guy, where we talk about basically the same shit you guys are talking about. Because what the internet needs more than anything is white dudes talking about old movies. That's what the internet is for.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
what we need.
This is white dude porn right here. So if you need more white dudes talking about old movies,
mm-hmm.
Ty and That Guy is out there.
Yeah. Hop out a purple cloud of smoke, you know, sit down on the couch, make yourself happy and comfortable.
Ooh, yeah. Absolutely. And thanks, everybody, for watching and or listening. This has been the Escapist Movie Podcast. And bye. Credits. They can still hear us, though, but these are the credits. Cool.
Thanks, guys, for having me come hang out. I gotta go.